Clock strikes seven. Welcome, everyone. It's good to see you all here. I'm Christine Green, resident of St Neots, member of this church, and member of St Neots Town Council. We will finish by 9 o'clock at the latest, but if you need to leave sooner, obviously feel free to do so. Welcome to our candidates. Thank you very much for coming. Good to see you all here. We regret that Mr. Djanogly is busy tonight, and we're sorry not to have him with us, but he will be attending the Hustings in St Ives tomorrow evening at 7:30, just he's at the Methodist Church. Okay? Our candidates will speak at the beginning, in alphabetical order, from the lectern here, for 2 minutes. And I will stop them at 2 minutes if they go on, and they all know that, so I'll try to do it politely, should that happen. After that, Father Paul will chair your questions. Any questions from anyone at the moment? You're all happy with that? Okay, now during the questions, I will have a roving mic and we will attempt to cover all the hands that go up. When I get to you, if you're chosen, will you please stand, say your name, where you live, and if you're here to represent any organisation, to say who that is. Okay? Thank you very much. I think I've covered everything. Over to Father Paul. Thank you for bringing the chair. And I hope you find it a helpful evening, both candidates and audience. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. Well, I'd like to add my welcome. It's lovely to see people inside the church, and it's a joy to be able to welcome you to this beautiful building. It's also it's quite gratifying to have people coming in and say, isn't it nice and cool in here, rather than isn't it extremely cold in here? So only this window of about 3 months and we can do that. I think I want to just make a few routine safety announcements before we start. If anyone needs a loo while we're in session, I'm afraid they're in the church hall, which is the building directly behind us here. If you go out the way you came in and just follow the path round, it's the big grey door. I'm sure our discussion becomes so heated that we need to evacuate the building. Then the emergency exit again is the door that you came in, but there is another exit at the back, which is a small door in the big door. You need to be careful both of your feet and your head if you go through that one. But I don't anticipate that that's a very unlikely occurrence. As Christine said, the candidates have been invited to speak for 2 minutes, and so I'd like to invite Paul Bullen to present.
Thank you, Father Paul. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. If I could say thank you all for coming, for taking the time now to at least come and hear what we have to say. Thanks to your certainly Labour supporters here, I've just got supporters from each of the political parties, as well as the independents. Being the same here, it happens to have the best independent local councillors I know, and none of them belong to a political party. I don't for a political party, and it's the UK Independence Party, but make the same, we are totally independent. Unlike the other parties, we have no party whip, and therefore every UKIP politician is free to do whatever they believe is right for the people they represent. This general election is a unique general election. It is about how the Brexit negotiations will be handled in the years to come, and this, in my opinion, makes UKIP more important than ever before. In addition to that, there are the policies that only UKIP is prepared to commit to. Reducing net migration, putting integration at the top of the political agenda, abolishing the House of Lords, and creating an English Parliament. Make no mistake, the referendum only happened because of UKIP. And UKIP is the only party who will continue to fight in Parliament for the correct deal for the UK. During the referendum campaign, our current MP and the Prime Minister fought for us to remain in the EU, and they still believe that we should do, as do some of the other political parties. I don't trust them when it comes to voting on a Brexit deal that is the right one for the UK. And they will, I'm sure, keep many pro-EU agreements in place. Now, as the majority of our constituency voted to leave, in my opinion, we should have an MP who truly represents their views, or indeed your views, and not one who will oppose those views when it comes to voting in Parliament. If the Prime Minister begins to backslide during the Brexit negotiations, she must know that UKIP will be there. We are the country's insurance policy, the guardians of Brexit. We have fought for Brexit all of our political lives, and we want to ensure that the people get the kind of Brexit they voted for. As your MP, I will hold government to account, fight for the right Brexit deal for the UK and not the EU, and most importantly, represent you to the very best of my ability. Thank you.
So this general election is about a number of important issues for Huntingdon. It's about whether you're prepared to see key services like the NHS, like adult social care, education, continue to be eroded. It's about how we help those who are less fortunate than us. And it's about how we manage the growth that's happening around us. And it is about the impact of Brexit on this area. Now, some of you may know me as the mayoral candidate, as a councillor in Cambridge, as a trustee of Winter Comfort for the Homeless. Fewer of you most probably know me as a marathon runner, and most probably even fewer as a Derby County supporter. But as I've gone round this constituency over the last few months, people have told me that they're concerned about the cost of housing, they're concerned about congestion, they're concerned about the cuts to benefits and about the cuts to critical services. And they're also worried about the impact of Brexit. And they also tell me that they want an MP who will stand up for them. So as your MP, I will be a strong voice for Huntingdon. And I will be the MP for everyone across the constituency, fighting for more funding for those key services, fighting for more funding for those who aren't well off, fighting to ensure that where there is growth, it's done on a sustainable basis, with more social and affordable housing, better public transport, proper community infrastructure. And I will also fight on Brexit to ensure that European nationals have a right to stay, to ensure that we continue to be part of the single market, and to ensure that Huntingdon is cushioned from the impact of Brexit. So as your MP, I will be a strong voice for you, a strong voice for the people of Huntingdon, a strong voice locally, a strong voice regionally, and most importantly, a strong voice nationally. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you for coming out. My name's Nik Johnson. My official title is Dr. Nik Johnson, or to my patients, Dr. Nik. I stand before you for the very simple reason that I think I could be the best MP, Member of Parliament, for Huntingdon. I stood 2 years ago. I did, I think, quite successfully in that position. And I want to continue that fight. When it comes down to it, when I look at this, I see it as a bit like a job interview. At the moment, I'm feeling a bit nervous, but I know I've sent my CV out to you. You hopefully will have received something in terms of the literature that I'm sending. But I'm standing as a Labour Party candidate. But at heart, I'm a public servant. I work in the local hospital. I'm passionate about the survival and the long-term future of each of your hospital. And I want to see St. Neots as my town, the town which I access on a regular basis at the weekends, during the day for the shopping, to thrive. I've always had done since I moved to the area, at the heart of the community. And being at the heart of the community, doing a job in the NHS, I listen to people. Because what I feel that a Member of Parliament should be doing is actually representing all of your views. Now, I'm not going to try and pretend I'm anything that I'm not. I'm a Labour Party candidate. And I think what's been put out into the mainstream in the manifesto is a strong idea for the future of this country. people are starting to warm to it. There are ideas that have been put forward by their leader, Jeremy Corbyn, that people are beginning to come round to. Things that we haven't heard about in a long time. We can talk about issues around nationalisation of the railways or changing the way that the energy supplies, but they are beginning to change people's minds. Even Mrs. May has started to realise that capping energy prices is a good idea. At heart, it's all about care and compassion. I want to be that local candidate that commutes. I want to remain with my family at the centre of the community, the centre for my constituents, going backwards and forwards on a daily basis, not being in some sort of ivory tower.
Good evening, my name is Tom MacLennan and I am the Green Party candidate for Huntingdon this time, and I was in 2015. I am a science teacher, a father of six children who live in the constituency opposite, and I am a local copy as part of what I do in the community. This election matters hugely. It's unexpected, no one was ready for it, except Theresa May. And we have hopefully got to galvanise a response to this, basically, an idea that she thinks that she can take the country for granted. The Green Party had many ideas. In fact, if you look at the Labour manifesto now, it's very much like the manifesto we had in 2015, and many of the ideas, like public transport and renationalising the railways, were our ideas. And again, I'd like to say, the Green Party have good ideas. They might seem radical, but eventually when people think about them, they really do come to the fore. They are the answer to many of the problems that we have in this day and age. The problems we have are stemmed not from Brexit, that hasn't happened yet, but the wobble is beginning because of the way it's being handled. The problems we have are due to austerity. The problems we have in our NHS, where there is huge underfunding of massive amounts of funded things that must have got to look after, like buildings. There's a $10 billion infrastructure bill we have to match. We can't fund at the moment. There are problems funding nurses. There are problems funding doctors. We have strikes left, right, and centre. The nurses want to go on strike. In the public sector, we have some strikes with the prison service. They're banned from striking, but they're so desperately in need because of austerity and underfunding. The Conservatives haven't any of these answers. Theresa May has basically turned around and said, Brexit, hard Brexit, Brexit means Brexit, and then she's gone away. She has no answers. The manifesto has no numbers. She's basically just hoping that the disarray in any of the major parties means that she doesn't have... I'm very grateful. I hope to answer your questions in the fourth way.
Well, thank you to all the candidates for those presentations. And now it's over to you. Christine has a roving microphone. In addition to saying who you are, where you come from, and if you represent a particular group, if your question is primarily for any one of the candidates, perhaps you could say so as you say it, and then we can we'll share the discussion anyway, but we'll put it for that candidate first. So who's first? In the blue t-shirt over that time. It's a very sensitive line, so you don't need to swallow it.
Hi there, I'm Luke from Ainsley. Sorry, I'm Luke from Ainsley. Just a very simple question, actually. What does Neots mean to all four of you?
Paul, would you like to go first?
Yeah, as until recently, our local county's councillor. I believe that Shane Neots for many years has been treated as a poor relation of Huntingdon. I believe that the majority of the Huntingdon District Councillors who make the decisions in Cabinet are from the Huntingdon and St Ives area, and that part of the county probably gets more attention than St Neots does. As a marine surveyor, you've got a beautiful waterfront here. I'm in St Neots quite often. But I can see the state of some of the roads in St. Neots that we don't have, certainly in my expedition of St. Ives, where I now live in Stupid. So I believe that St. Neots, it is the largest town in the county. It is at a crossroads of our communication links, and I believe it needs a better representation both locally and nationally.
Thank you. Lord?
St. Neots for me means a place with a strong sense of community that goes back a long way. I mean, you know, local shops, places like Barrett's that have been around for over 100 years, a sense of community where some people don't have a lot of money, but the sense of community is strong. It's a place where growth is happening to it. Barracks has just announced it was closing or changing its nature of trading. You see growth at Love Farm, and that growth doesn't have any infrastructure attached to it. Well, the infrastructure comes long after the houses are built. And I think those are some of the challenges that this community faces. And those types of things have been happening to the community, and actually you haven't had a strong voice standing up for you, not recently, and you need a strong voice so that if that growth is happening, you get the correct community infrastructure before the houses are built. Doctor's surgeries, community centres, those are the types of things that you need if you are going to have that growth. And you're as aware as I am that that growth is coming. That growth is coming.
Thank you.
Well, if you don't mind, I'm used to standing up. It's kind of, I'm told it helps your voice.
As if anyone can't hear anything, this person could be good way around.
Thank you for the question. St. Neots, what does it mean to me? Well, where do I start? St. Neots Rugby Club, always there. I could go list you off 7 primary schools that I'm regularly in and out of in terms of I need to know where my patients are at. I know about, it's my hometown. It's where I live, not a million miles away here, and I'm backwards and forwards. But in terms of trying to put myself at the heart of the community, I think I get to understand what the people of St. Neots need. I think people already have articulated an issue about a burdening growth. I know on St. Love's Farm, that's where St. Love's Farm, Love's Farm, which has obviously grown, there's currently an issue around pestilence and possibly rats infecting that. I'm a regular subscriber in terms of the St. Neots Forum. I've embedded myself over the last 11 years whilst I've lived here to understand on a day-to-day basis. And the colleagues on the right here, I will pick them up in that they have done district council, county council work. That is not something I've been doing. I've been a public servant working within the NHS, and in that meantime I've been liaising with education. I go into Sam Peeps on a regular basis. I was very proud that they asked me to be a governor, and the only thing I said, I'm sorry I can't do it because I'm a bit busy. For me, St. Neots encapsulates one of the reasons I moved to Cambridgeshire. I was lucky enough when my wife got a job in Addenbrookes. We had to look for an area. I live in a small village just past Abbotsley. It's a lovely place. It's where I come for my leisure time, but it's where I want to represent the people because, as we've already mentioned, St. Neots has been forgotten about. It is the biggest market town, and there may be reasons for that because of the way that the Huntingdonshire District Council is set up and there's a focus on what's provided there. And I'm not going to downplay Huntingdon because that's actually where I work. But we need to understand that St. Neots has opportunity. St. Neots has hope. And with a burdening and a very young population, I think it's Winteringham Park, which is about to come on chat before too long, and hopefully with an improvement in the A428 in terms of the orange route and making sure we get an orange route which actually has the connection not just down to the south of the Black Cat, but also to the right of Love's Farm, we will have a vibrant market town. And not only that, you will have a local MP in me who will be sticking up for St. Neots. Thank you.
Thank you.
St. Neots, whenever I think of it, is a beautiful place to visit. Many years ago I used to live in London. My family moved away from the area and moved to London, and eventually I've come back. And when I lived in London, I worked in Bedford, and whenever I asked colleagues where I should be moving to while we were house hunting, St. Neots kept coming up. Unfortunately, I couldn't afford to live around here. So it's a little pricey in my mind. Because at that point, Love's Farm wasn't on chat. It was before big housing advancement was going on. But at the moment, my little boy is currently in the one leisure doing the fencing club. And for me, primarily, this area for me is education. I've worked in both Ernulf and in Longsands as a supply teacher over the years. In fact, I was there 2 years ago when Ernulf finally came out of super special measures. And that was a proud moment for all the teachers, and I've met them. They were hardworking. And it's, for me, it's about the youth. As a teacher, I always look at an area and I think about how young people fit in and what their opportunities are. And I think that some Neots needs investment. It needs infrastructure to go along with the huge expansion in housing that it's going to have. It needs the A428 sorting out. It needs the Black Cat sorting out. Whenever I think of Neots, honestly, the Black Cat comes up quite a lot as well. But for me, it's about making sure that the young people in the area have the best opportunities. That, I think, is what I think of Neots.
Thank you very much. Next question.
Stephen Cadden from Huntingdon. Just a question for Paul. You mentioned about doing away with the House of Lords. What would you replace it with? And beyond that, what is your attitude towards the monarchy? Thank you.
It's been on my press agency by line. We believe that England should have its own parliament, as the Welsh, Northern Ireland, Scotland do. And we believe our current parliament should be an English parliament. The House of Lords, which is unelected, should be gotten rid of, and that would then become the second house for the whole of the United Kingdom. What that actually means is if we have a house that makes decisions that affect the whole of the UK, but that each country within the United Kingdom would then have its own parliament or its own assembly to make decisions that are specific to that whole country. At the moment, England is the only country in the whole of Europe that doesn't have its own parliament. The monarchy, I like monarchy, I am a monarchist. I believe they do an awful lot of good for this country. They bring in a lot of tourism. The rest of the world looks at us when things happen with the royal family. As any other family, they have their up and downs, and all of us in this church today have been through up and downs of the royal family. But I think that they are an asset to this country. And long may they continue.
Thank you very much. Would any of the other candidates like to comment on a two-part question about the space of the House of Lords and the position in London?
Well, I'd like to comment on the fact that the House of Lords, acting as a bicameral chamber, by having a House of Oversight, to make sure that one party, one chamber, the tyranny of basically one chamber, you have the counteracting force on having a second chamber, is vital, I feel, for a proper modern democracy. I understand the idea of having an English parliament, but then England itself is hugely unwieldy compared to, say, Scotland or Wales. It would probably be better to have a regional system or to just go down to the county level. We already have county councils, we already have district councils, we already have town councils, so we actually need an extra layer of politics above that. We're, as the Green Party, weren't even in favour of all the elected mayors that we currently have. The idea, though, for me, is basically we need proportional representation of some form, because at the moment you are currently sitting in a constituency where four of us are very unlikely it to become the MP, sadly. Even though I know that everyone I spoke to said they'd vote for me, I'm sure I believe them. But the problem I have is that my vote for me might seem wasted. And in fact, in many cases, the three parties here, who represent, shall we say, the progressive side of politics, and from that perspective, we, without proportional representation of some form, we end up basically cancelling each other out and allowing a Tory majority, which means almost that you can basically have a Hustings and not even turn up.
Thank you. Robert.
I think a lot of people feel that the current system is broken. As my colleague said a moment ago, in many constituencies, there are many people whose vote doesn't have an impact in any shape or form across the country, and as a result of that, people become very disillusioned with the electoral system. And if you look at the House of Lords, our position is very clear. There needs to be a second chamber to act as a counterweight to primary legislation. And actually, a reformed House of Lords would provide that role. But we would go further. We'd give people who are 16 the right to vote. We would basically introduce a standard transferable vote system in terms of general elections. And actually, that then means that those people who, millions of people who voted for parties who have a very small disproportionate representation in Parliament would have a say. And actually, as I have knocked on doors and spoken to people, one of the biggest frustrations that they have is this sense that actually some parties feel that they have a right to basically be your MP. And actually, they're very frustrated with that position. Very frustrated.
Steve, if you don't mind me referring to the first name. First of all, as a doctor, thank you for making my heart race on that question, because I wasn't expecting that, and I think that's the first time I've ever had the House of Lords or monarchy come up. I'll keep it straight. I had to quickly look through my manifesto, and there's not actually anything made about that. And I know Mr. Corbyn was asked about this in one of his interviews. His position, and would be, and like mine, is that there's no plans to change in terms of regard to the monarchy. The Queen's been doing a good job, as we've already referred to, for the last however many years, and I'm sure she will continue doing it. I'm sure that when things happen and Charles comes to the throne, he has had some modern ideas, and hopefully that will change and make it, the royal family more relevant. And in regard to the House of Lords, again, there was changes introduced by the previous Labour government, which I think went a long way to improve some things in terms of getting rid of hereditary peerages. They're not completely gone. And I think if, in terms of the second chamber, it's an essential tool to look at legislation, to get people to think again, and I guess it would be true for any government that was in power, that it would be sensible to get the best brains, be they brains from education, the probation service, medicine, to make sure that the people that they put in there are the right people and not patsies who've either made donations through for political campaigning. And we should be more honest about that.
Can I just come back on that?
Yeah.
Just the point of view, the House of Lords has an appointed chamber. You can almost see the attraction of it. The idea that we take the best and the brightest and we give them a role in life. The problem is that automatically means that they're split because they're not actually even doing either job properly. Because if they're doing their job properly, and you want to co-opt them into the House of Lords, you're automatically damaging them doing that job properly. Far better, I feel, would be a system where you have elected representatives who you hold accountable based on the decisions that they make. But we rely heavily on the experts who basically tell us what's actually likely to be happening, what this was required, and therefore people in Parliament would act upon such decisions or make decisions based on that information versus ignoring experts and basically making a huge big scene of things.
I'm sure we're going to be very well behaved, but I would give an example who happens to be a Labour peer, so I'm going to fight his corner, is Lord Winston Smith, who I think most people would know as the specialist within the medical field, who's done some fantastic work about holding the government to account in terms of obstetrics type problems and you know, very ethical dilemmas based around edge of life resuscitation, all these things. And I think he has continued to do a fantastic job, and I've actually even had the pleasure of sort of working alongside him even when he was a Lord. So I don't think they're mutually exclusive. We have to be careful, but I think they can be done.
Thank you very much. Steve, do you have any comments? I'm glad no one touched on the position of bishops in the House of Lords. Move on to the next question very quickly. Thank you. Gentlemen, just here. And I did spot another hand at the back there, so wave it around next time.
Hi, my name's Rob Carpenter. I come from Buckton, I live in Buckton. I also have to invest in all your parties. So that's what I need my colours to the mast when Jeremy Corbyn became the leader. My question is really related to public services. I belong to two other organisations, KOMP, People and National Gazette Public, and the School Cuts Organisation. So it's a question about public services. And my fear is that if this Tory government is re-elected, they're going to do proper damage to our public services. I don't know if you're aware, but The King's Fund produced another report. They are the premier think tank in NHS policy. And they have actually said that the underfunding situation in the health service, which is well known, it's been talked about for a long, long time, and the government's basically ignored it, that it's reaching critical. We've been calling it a crisis for a long time, but it's hypercritical. And the Royal College of Nursing, I'm an ex-nurse, that's the reason I'm interested in this issue, have said that we're short 40,000 nurses. 40,000 nurses we haven't got in the health service. Partly because of the 1% salary cap we've had for the last 7 years, partly because we started paying with withdrawn bursaries from nursing students. And they just quote me something and ask you to respond to these quotes. And they were made yesterday. One is by Mark Porter, the chairman of the British Medical Association. To quote, the NHS is now in a position where it's put off spending because the money has run out, leaving patients waiting and paying in uncertainty. He calls it a disgraceful failure for our patients. And here's an important statement. Financial targets shouldn't take priority over this need to provide safe and high-quality care. My General Secretary of the Royal College of Nursing has said, it's been a political decision not to get the NHS money, the money it needs in recent years. Could I just ask you also to talk about our loss of office school cuts organisation and the underfunding of the education system? It's had 7% cut since 2015. There'll be $3 billion down by the time 2020 comes. So, in the loss, I'd ask anybody to feed into Google school cuts organisation and find out how many teachers your local school is going to lose. Thank you.
Thank you. And that's two very big questions. Yeah. I think actually, let me take them separately. I would have thought you'd like to say anything about the financing of that house.
To be perfectly honest, when I said it's been taken in a different context. But if you get a look at our manifesto, we will commit to investing an extra $11 billion every year in the NHS and social by the end of the next parliament. We'll raise capital medical school and nurse grade basis and increase funding for mental health and dementia. We'll scrap tuition fees for science, technology, engineering, mathematics and medical students. We will maintain all of the pensioners' benefits and the pensioners' triple lot. We will protect disability and carers' benefits. And we will commission a dedicated hospital ship for use both here in the military and overseas. But the question I think you asked first was to do with public services. And I am not against, I would say this, privatisation where it can be proven that it's more efficient and that it works. However, I do agree that a large number of our public services should never have been passed into the private sector. And within those, I would agree on our major transport systems, railways, road maintenance, which I see, or it sees a county council, where we spend millions of pounds to private companies who make a huge profit, when actually, when we had the old highways departments within our local council, we actually did a better job than we achieved. The NHS, my personal opinion, should not be looked after by politicians. It should be given its independence. The managers should be got rid of, and it should be run by clinicians who know about the service that they need to provide. Clearly, Nick knows more about the NHS than I do, but I'm a businessman as well as an ex-military officer, and I know how to run things financially and properly, and how to make budgets meet. Unfortunately, in my opinion, the Labour Party has got to sort out its ineptitude when it comes to finances. They cannot be trusted with the public purse. I have had a Labour politician say to me that it's not real money, we don't have to pay it back, we can spend what we want. Well, we can't, because by spending, taxing, we're just leaving a huge debt for our children and our grandchildren. But at heart, I'm probably a socialist, certainly when it comes to the caring professions. But Labour needs to be able to balance it.
Thank you very much. I think that Nick may want to come back on certain aspects of that in a moment.
So, look, we've all experienced the NHS at some point of our lives, and typically it's always fantastic. And if you look locally, if you look at places like Hinchinbrook, if we rewound 2 years ago, sitting here, we were being told that Hinchinbrook had just come out of the private contract. It had a sustainable future. I remember going to a board meeting being told it had a sustainable future on its own. We now see it's not on its own anymore. It's been merged. One would question, 3 years, 5 years out, will Hinchinbrook still be open? And that's an illustration of the issues that we face. And as politicians, we just need to be open and honest with people that the NHS needs to be properly funded. That's the simple answer. It needs to be properly funded. And you ultimately can take that decision. Now, we as a party in this general election have made a clear statement that we're going to increase income tax by one pence, and that money is going to be ring-fenced for the NHS and adult social care. Because it's not just about the NHS. It's about other areas of care that are impacting on the NHS. And the cuts in social care in terms of council funding and at the same time the increase in demand have resulted in that being a knock-on into the NHS as well. Now, County Council, 80% of their funding approximately now is going into social care. They've cut everything else. And at the same time, that demand is increasing. And again, we need to have an open and honest conversation with people about those issues. And the other thing I would say is that, you know, as a party, I welcome the fact that we would remove the cap of 1% increase on employees in the NHS. And actually, the Institute of Fiscal Studies looked at the main party's manifestos and actually said ours was the one which actually made economic sense and actually balanced.
And I've got to take issue with that. There is one party that has had their manifesto and their funds independently audited, and only one party, and that is UKIP, both in the last manifesto and in this one. For you to say that and say that downright lie, you show me an independent party that your party
Institute
has about your sons. You're another party of taxation.
The Institute of Fiscal Studies is independent, completely independent. And it's taken those key parties, it's taken the main party's manifestos and looked at those manifestos and said whether or not economically they make sense. And so it is important in this election. It's not just about Brexit, but Brexit will also impact the NHS. Because in this region, a lot of those people who are caring for you are not from this country. Are from overseas, and depending on how Brexit turns out, they may not stay here. They may not stay here, and we'll have yet another crisis in relation to the NHS. So there are some very major issues in relation to healthcare, in relation to the NHS and social care, that we need to grip as part of this election, as part of the debate that we're having in relation to the next government.
Nick,
would
you like to comment?
I'm conscious that doing the same order every time. I don't know if we should be mixing it around. I'm happy to speak. It sort of plays, obviously, maybe to my strengths, speaking here as a medic. NHS funding, I think, to put it from the point of view of the party mine, is that there's a quite clear commitment to invest up to £30 billion. And that's, you know, we can talk about how we're going to do it, but when it comes down to it, the decision is, in this election, what is really difficult is I think there has been some more kind of grown-up discussions across some of the political parties about a willingness to talk about taxation. And in terms of trying to find that £30 billion, it's been made quite clear that it's about identifying, raising tax from corporations and from the few. We've talked about, you know, we're going to look after the many, but the few are going to have to pay a little bit more. I am one of those people. I am lucky enough to work in the NHS, and I see the benefits by putting aside a little bit more, those who can afford a little bit more, and actually taking corporation tax back to a level, not to the very highest levels, not to about the low average for the rest of Europe. That's where the funding is going to come to.
Why we need to do it? Well, I'll tell you why. It's already been touched on. 2 years ago, I campaigned very much on about be aware in Shinbrook Hospital is we're going to lose it. I still work there. I'm very proud to work there, and it has changed. There are things that maybe you're not aware of, but services have left. There's been a few coming the other way talk about clinical viability, but actually, the issue, I'm so worried about it that you, some of you may be aware that I'm also taking on another role, a public governor role, where I do this in my spare time and I go to work, but because I was, just to be clear, I work within the Cambridge Community Services NHS Trust, which is not a staff member on site in Inchigal. I realised there was a possibility for me to be like you, a member of the community that follows a foundation trust. And I now, I only did it this week, I can hold, as a governor, like a school governor maybe, the board of North West Anglia NHS Trust to account, particularly for the people of Huntingdon. That's my passion. That's why I did it. I mean, it can't be job preservation as well. But I can't be an MP. I want to be a bloody good doctor, but I can't be a bloody good doctor in a local hospital if it's not there. And there are worries. Maternity is still vulnerable. The paediatric services are very vulnerable. And do not forget that there was talk about an urgent care centre. An urgent care centre is not an A&E department. And if we have an urgent care centre, there will be a very big change in the priorities of blue light ambulances coming to Hinchinbrook Hospital. If you're a seriously ill child, define that as you will not be taking your child to Hinchinbrook Hospital. If you have a fall, if you have what is described as a complicated fracture, well, that could just as easily be a fractured neck of femur, the most common injury that happens, you know, in one of our sort of residential homes here for the elderly. But that's not going to your local hospital, that's going elsewhere now. The point is, I might be jumping ahead of myself. I want to be your local MP, but by God, I want to be the Minister of Health as well. I want Jeremy Hunt's job because I was in. I do have the knowledge, and I think I could have the respect of the NHS workers that we rely on so much.
Thank you. Thomas.
I'd like to be Prime Minister. because there is so much to fix, you've highlighted two major problems, the NHS and education. And I spent 2 years working as a blood scientist at the Royal London, and now I'm a science teacher in Peterborough. So I have experience of both worlds. And I've been in public service all my life, except odd jobs as a child. The NHS is vital. It's almost like a religion, but it's under threat, and it has been under threat since the 1980s. Oliver Letwin, whose constituency I drove through on Monday, wrote a book in the 1980s basically saying how he was going to privatise it and how it should be done, and how you want to fund it to the point where it begins to creak and then it begins to crumble, and everyone is crying out for you to come and fix it, and then private money turns up and it's all good, and Virgin money or Virgin healthcare, and we end up with this dismembered system. Only today there was a report came out, the Naylor report, talking about how they're going to start selling off NHS land to, because the land, the estate isn't necessary, it's about providing the service. But if you take the, in the same way it's taking school playing fields away, because once they were turned into academies, the academies could sell them because they were playing to their own rules. It's about funding. It's about funding it fairly. It's about basically making sure that the money in this country, this fifth largest economy on earth, where money may or may not be real, but in itself, it basically all it has to do is flow. And the money must flow. And the problem is there's a huge amount of money basically being coalesced into the few. The 1% get richer and the money gets concentrated, and there's this idea that trickle-down economics will work for us all. But it doesn't work. You've got to have JFK, John F. Kennedy, turned around and said, a rising tide floats all boats. And that, for me, is basically the principle we should apply. We should make sure that the people who have the money at the top of society pay their fair share. We're not being punitive. We don't want to take away their yachts. We want them to basically make sure that they pay a slightly larger percentage on money above the same tax brackets that everyone else would pay. And it's important that the education service, where I have been, I'm currently in a school where 16 TAs, teaching assistants, were let go last year. We've got consultations now for basically teachers who can no longer be funded, because it's not just the block grant that gets taken away, it's all the ancillary funding. And my school lost almost £750,000, and you suddenly find the head teacher just looking desperate as he's constantly trying to find money here and there and everywhere, trying to maintain. These are people he has relationships with, people he's worked with for years, and he has to let them go. It's not fair, because these people have lives, and then suddenly they lose out. And also the children in the school lose out, because suddenly that person who was having intervention can no longer be looked after in the same way, so they're back into the main class, and they're not looked after as well as they could be in a fair system, because there are an awful lot of children with special educational needs who are no longer having those needs met. The NHS is just like British Rail, in the sense that they are underfunding it, and then they'll turn around and say that privatisation is the answer, and we all can see how that went. For me, the answer is basically to get rid of the internal market. The NHS has a budget of around about £120 billion a year, round about. 15% of that is spent on form filling, to make sure that basically you can have outsourcing of different market things. 15% of it is spent on the internal market. Get rid of that, and you would solve an awful lot of the problems inside the NHS.
Okay, thank you.
So, look, I mean, education should be the most important thing in life. I come from a North Nottinghamshire mining community. I benefited from free state education. I was very fortunate to go to university, again free. And all my life chances have been enhanced purely through education. So, for us to sit here now in this stark position where the schools locally are being their funding is being cut and they're having to take some very drastic decisions, it's disgraceful. It's really disgraceful. Because not only are we impacting children today, but we're impacting society tomorrow from a very short-term decision. And this county suffers historically from having a funding formula, education funding formula, which is one of the lowest in the country. So it starts from a disadvantaged position. And then to have the cuts that are coming through the system now in a way that actually just exaggerates that position, it's disgraceful. And then you lay on top of that the issues that I've heard about on the doorstep over the last few months, where teachers, because they can't afford to live in this region, are voting with their feet. They're just moving. They're moving to somewhere else. Because firstly, housing is cheaper. Secondly, they don't have to commute for an hour and a half just to get to the school where they want to work. So there is a teaching shortage as well that's hitting us within this area. And those factors will have a material impact on our children and the future generations of this constituency. And it's something we should shout about. And it's something we should argue with the government, that actually education should be one of the key things. And in our manifesto, we would put £7 billion back into education, and we would reverse the cuts that are currently being put in place by the Conservative government. Because, as I said, it is the most important thing. It's about the future generations of our society.
Will the legislative education be publicly or privately funded?
Now, I believe education should be publicly funded and it should be free to all. I believe that the children, our children, are our future, and our children's children are their future. As a businessman, I've been very lucky in that I have employed not hundreds but tens of people over the last 24 years. And I must admit, I'm astounded at the level of basic education. I've employed people who are very intelligent, but they can't read, they can't write, and they can't do basic arithmetic. I think our whole education system needs to be looked at. I believe that the education system we have at the moment is not producing what we need in the workforce at the moment. I was astounded when apprenticeships were more or less got rid of some time ago. I'm very glad that they're now starting to come back. I do not believe that every single child is an academic and that they should all go to university. I believe some have other skills, specifically in building, electricians, plumbing, engineering as well. So apprenticeships are very important, but not everybody needs to go to university. But I do believe that the education should be provided by the public purse, that it should be free to everybody, to whatever level they wish to go to. And again, I'm actually going to agree with most of what Rob said. Cambridgeshire is one of the most underfunded counties in the country, and it has been for many years. And for all the time, we have had Conservative-run councils and Conservative MPs, that funding has continued to fall. And indeed, Alconbury School, I had a conversation with somebody there today, their funding has fallen consecutively every single year since Jonathon Djanogly was elected as the MP for Huntingdon. And he lives in Alconbury. He can't even sort out the funding for his own school. So the whole education system is looking at. I think that he is looking at internally, but certainly the funding and the training of teachers, etc., he's looking at nationally as well.
Can I just add that it's not just about school education, it's about further education as well. And many people are aware that there's been an area review of further education. So Huntingdon Regional College has merged with Cambridge Regional College. The impact of that is that basically people who want to get those skills and have left school have to basically travel more. What has happened is that actually there has been a cut in the bus funding for young people at the age of 16. So at the moment, those colleges are funding the bus fares for those people, and they in turn have just received a cut from the government. So they are going to not be able to continue to fund those bus fares. So let me put this hypothesis to you, that somebody will end up taking a life decision for the cost of a bus fare. So they'll take a low-skilled job locally in their village or in their town, rather than being able to afford a bus fare to go to the regional college and get skills. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. And that just illustrates some of the problems we have, not just in primary and secondary education, but also in that further education, that key area where basically people who aren't going to university need to have those skills that we as a region, actually, the employers are looking for. But actually, they can't get them for the cost of a bus fare.
I guess education, as we've moved on, we may actually have a bit of a full house here and obviously we have an empty chair, because when it comes down to it, I think we all acknowledge that there are proposals from the current government to reduce funding and cuts. It's personal to me. You know you're in trouble when the head teachers of 3,000 head teachers write from 14 counties, write to you and say, you've got to start speaking to your constituents. You've got to go and start speaking to the people who want to represent you. Little did the headmaster know when he wrote to me, he was actually thought of, I was one of those very people. And he then provided me with all the information about the £3 billion that's been withdrawn. I don't propose to go over the same ground over and over again. For me, it's about reduction in the class sizes. It is about maintaining that free state education. We need to retain our teachers. And as you may know, and sort of maybe we're alluding to, the one thing that the Labour Party is also talking about is the getting rid of tuition fees, because I think it's not just about taking people through the early start, the sure start, investing in children at the very earliest stage, taking them through nursery places, taking them through education, and then letting them blossom in further education. There's one other thing which, you know, I have a particular special interest in. It's the issue of school meals. Now, that's within the education budget, and for me, making sure that all the primary school children have a good meal every day. We actually have to be very careful about abolishment, careful of children who actually go hungry in the holidays between their school meals. That is a dreadful thing that is happening in this, what we are told, the fifth richest country in the world. So, I'm absolutely opposed to the cuts. I'm very proud that Mr Corbyn and the Labour Party are proposing huge investment in education. And it may have been a previous member of the Labour Party who once said, education, 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 but by God, it's the same thing again.
I actually live in Auckland as well, and I was a governor at the school in question. And it's not just the fact that we're in Cambridgeshire, and Cambridgeshire has the lowest... had the lowest bottom, shall I say, funding out of all of the counties at the time.
When that funding, the funding system used to be county-based, and then it got basically nationalised, but instead of having a national funding formula years ago, they just kept the same as the counties. It was just a bizarre decision. But even within Cambridgeshire, Alphenbury actually has the lowest funding with it. So it's actually one of the poorest funded schools in the country. And then I now work in Peterborough, and previously, children on the other side of that little border, past Yaxley, were receiving about £550 a year more per child. And that's an incredible difference for a school to try and basically deal with. And the reason I mentioned education last time, I mentioned healthcare this time, hopefully, because it all links together. It's all about one holistic understanding of what is actually going on. It is a fragmentation of our public services, basically for the profit of private companies. Private companies are given carte blanche, basically, to take over public services for local councils. They then basically don't provide as good a service because they can't pay the same as they did. And it's just a giant circle of basically disintegration. Municipal councils have recently taken lots of services back in-house, and things are, they're saving money. The NHS requires a huge input in money, but it can be solved if you get away from the problems that have been caused partly by the coalition government, where the 2012 Health and Social Care Act basically removed the need for the health secretary to provide education. All he had to do was arrange it. Suddenly, that one little sentence allowed a huge change in methodology within Parliament. And the same thing with education. You're going to see a fragmentation of the academy system, the free schools project, where basically there's huge amounts of funding for pet projects like that, grammar schools. And I'm a grammar school boy, I went to a grammar school, but I am opposed to them simply because they're wrong-headed. It's better to have education for everyone that's well-funded, instead of worrying that you're going to get your child into that best school, and then all of the, shall we say, more well-to-do or more, shall we say, able parents shove their children as close as they can and force them into the school, and leading to sink schools all across the bone. And that will happen again and again with grammars. It's not the idea of that being the answer is ridiculous. But again, it's all that seems to be in the Conservative manifesto. Grammar schools and free schools and maintaining the sense that we've got to fragment things. Give people choice. When actually, in the case of education, it should be that the choice is you send your children to a good school, and every school should be a good school.
Thank you. Education and health are very big topics.
I'm Nigel Corleo from God Manchester. You call me the Prince Neots.
Doesn't carry at the back.
I'm a member of SNIS, GoFOP, and the Labour Party as well, but this is a general question. It's about social housing. Tom mentioned earlier that he can afford a house in St Neots. I'm quite interested in what the panel think about social housing. 40% of people in this area earn below the national average wage. The average price of a house in St Neots is £300,000. There are tens of thousands of houses being built in this area, but most of them are executive homes, which are beyond means of people living here. I wonder what the panel think they could do to try and solve the crisis when we have 2,000 people on the waiting list for Huntingdon District Council homes, which are still going to be there after Alphenbury is built and all the homes are built in the area, the 76,000 being built in the next 20 years. There will still be 2,000 people who won't be able to have homes, and many people who can't afford homes. So I'd be quite interested. It's very good to say we'll build social houses. What, as an MP, would you do to solve the housing crisis and give our young people a chance to get on the housing ladder?
The social housing crisis,
yes. Well, yes, I would. And I'll keep it brief. I think we all know there is a problem being St Neots, Huntingdon, or St Ives. For me, the biggest frustration as we see large numbers of houses being built in a very popular area is time and time again seeing rather large, big property developers being given carte blanche, large tracts of land, putting on as we talk about the executive homes and failing to deliver on the value added that you meant to get to the development of residential developments. And what I mean by that is being actually robust and ensuring that the affordable housing that is meant to go alongside these developments is kept at 40%. We need mixed communities. We don't need more large executive houses full of consultants, golf players maybe. We need people because in our communities, we need people who can afford to live in the houses who will service all of our things, service the schools, service the hospitals, service the probation service, service the prisons. It comes down to what I would do. I would be expecting to make sure that that is deliverable. There are other issues around the rental market, which the Labour Party is proposing much more stricter exploitative contracts, which are fees, which are around the rental agreements, and indeed sort of making sure that rents are not in themselves exploitative. But when it comes down to it, in very simple terms, with the bulk of housing and what's been proposed in terms of the Labour Party is a massive housing enlargement in numbers, something akin to what happened in 1947 with the Attlee government, recognising we are in dire need, and we're going to have to be quite grown up about it. There will be areas of the country where big towns are going to build. We already see it. If it's done in a sustainable way, be it Camborne, it needs to be done in Norstoke, we will see an improvement. We will have communities, but we need to make sure that when those buildings are put up together, I would also be recommending that rather than using big conglomerates, the Woodrow Wyatts or whatever, we're using local builders. We should be putting down these small areas, little nuggets of land, and trying to invest in local builders, bringing in their expertise, freeing up the land for these people, and then in itself, ideally moving over even to what we call the cooperative movement, ideas of people working together and putting that together and delivering affordable housing. So when it comes down to it, the main issue is making sure that the 40%, which is an old development, we deliver on that and not somehow find a reason that it's not able to deliver it because they're worried about the profit. If the profits are short-lived for those companies, we need to be profiting as the local population by making sure the schools are built, making sure that the healthcare centres are built, the roads, the infrastructure, so that we can move forward and actually have healthy, thriving communities which have enough parking, because that will make the future district and county councillors a lot more happy, because that's one of the biggest problems I ever come across when I go out campaigning. Parking, because there's not enough space, and make sure you've got some gardens as well, because you get too much flash flooding by putting too much intensive housing and it just comes into the drains. So, few thoughts, that's how I see the world. Affordable housing, 40%.
Thank you.
One of the gigantic crises that's been caused is the fact that the housing association homes are being sold off to those people who are living in them, yet can afford the mortgage and have to be only around about £40,000 a year to be able to afford the mortgage. And yet the money for that sale is also being found by the council. The government basically forced councils and housing association homes to sell off their homes in some form of echo of Margaret Thatcher. I used to live in Dagenham, next to the Beckentree housing estate, the largest housing estate in Europe. And it was basically built, obviously, after the Second World War to take in the people from the East End. It is vital that areas are invested in, because if you don't invest, you end up with problems in social. You end up with huge problems, basically, in making sure that you don't end up with ghettoisation. You end up with people being socially cohesive. Then we have the opposite problem with places like Aldenbury Weald, and I have family members planning on moving to the area, and they look at it and they go, "Wow, these are lovely places." But they're huge, and I look at the plans, you go and look at these wonderful houses, you go, good grief. You look at the price, and you go, wow, there's no way anyone in the local area, my children, when they grow up, are going to have to move further north or somewhere else to be able to afford to buy a home. It's just this constant spread from London, the idea, well, we can get to London, we have huge inflated prices. Or Cambridge. Cambridge seems to be becoming a great central city, and everything around it is getting much more and more expensive. There has to be a social message spread through housing. You've got to basically make sure that people, landowners, cannot just sit on giant land banks while they get more and more expensive and then build houses on it saying, well, we need to make a profit. They wait, they hold it so that the house price bubble goes up. However, weirdly enough, we actually are currently sitting in a situation where the house prices have dropped for the last 3 months, which basically, again, should be something which is highlighted in the election, if nothing else, that the economy is faltering, and we've got this overinflated housing bubble already. We've got big problems when it comes to housing and making sure that people don't suffer homelessness, that people don't suffer the idea that they have to move away. You don't end up with ethnic, or social cleansing, you end up with social cleansing of areas to basically, and gentrification, they call it. It's depressing. But again, it's just a symptom of the whole. The idea that no one looks at things in a cohesive, for the people, democratically elected by the people, basically making sure that they're actually on the people's side, instead of constantly just basically saying, well, we can sign that off and sign that off and there's no consequences. Mr. Jarvie, we couldn't turn up tonight, I don't know why. However, again, I guarantee he will be returned as the MP. I hope he isn't. I hope I am. If not myself, then I hope a couple of these gentlemen. However, don't apologise, but Donald Trump's a businessman as well, I'm not entirely now. It's important that we get an understanding of what governments should be for. It should be for the people. Abraham Lincoln said it, for the people, by the people, of the people. It must be done that way. We should have people working for the social good, and instead of just basically waiting and waiting for things to just keep getting worse and worse and worse and just going, oh, well, that's the way it is. It used to be great, but it was never going to be as good as it used to be. We're the fifth richest, largest economy. We're richer now than we almost ever have been. And yet we're unhappy, we're depressed all the time, we're constantly exposed to the idea that things are broken. You know, everything, public social care is a mess.
Can I bring back to housing?
Sure. and social housing is in dire need.
Thank you.
This is a huge problem, and housing has been a huge problem since Maggie Thatcher decided to do the right thing. Now, I actually believe the old saying that an Englishman's home is his castle, and I actually agree with Margaret Thatcher on introducing the right to buy. Where I don't agree with Margaret Thatcher's policy, and I don't agree with every single government since then, was what they should have done with the income of those right to buys was to build more, better, modern social housing. And that didn't happen. It is starting to happen now. If any of you follow Cantrill County Council, you'll notice that, and I was instrumental in forming this, they've now formed a private limited company called the Cantrill Housing and Investment Company. The County Council now has, and it had slightly less now, £1.2 billion worth of land. It's going to use some of that land now to build housing, which a proportion will be sold, and a proportion will be rented at market rent. Any profit from that company will then be put back into providing services for those communities. The biggest mistake we made from a district council perspective was to sell off what used to be called council houses to RSLs, registered social landlords. I think we have one of the worst RSLs in the country in Huntingdonshire. And I'm not going to mention them by name, it's been in the paper probably maybe. They're not here, none of their representatives are here to defend themselves. And I won't have a go at them if they're not able to do so. But I think we need to bring social housing back into the public domain, completely back into the public domain. But what we've got to also think about is we cannot continue to build on our green belt. So we need to look at everything properly. We're an island. The island is not growing, but the population is. And regardless of what some of my colleagues on the left here who actually think, one of the biggest problems we have in this country, which is housing is included and to all of our services, is we cannot sustain forever net migration of in excess of 300,000 people every single year. We've got to stop it. If we don't stop it, we'll never be able to look after our housing problems, we'll never be able to provide decent education, we'll never be able to provide a national health service. It is a national health service, not an internet. But we've got to take a grip on migration, because an island the size of the UK cannot sustain what is currently happening.
So Let me give you a couple of facts. In 2011, the average price of a house in Huntingdon was £211,000. And at the end of 2016, the average price was £274,000. Now, during that period, inflation most probably was around 1 to 2%. So that just illustrates what has happened locally during that period of time, about 5 or 6 years. The affordability of housing, which is a measure of that price against the average size, is 9.6 times. Nobody can afford to buy a house. No one. And the impact, the reason why we have a housing crisis, is it's the ripple effect from Cambridge. That people basically can't afford to live in Cambridge, so they will live further and further out. And that effect has an impact in terms of house prices locally here. You then have a factor in terms of that demand for housing and the need for new homes, and also the need for social and affordable homes in terms of those new homes. Now, it's good to achieve a 40% affordable housing ratio on a site, but I would go further. And actually, as part of the mayoral campaign, the combined authority of the mayor has £100 million to spend on affordable housing across the region, part of which will be allocated here in Huntingdon. And what my argument is that actually, on the land that is owned by local authorities, such as the County Council, such as Huntingdon District Council, it should be a higher ratio of social and affordable housing, at least a minimum of 50%, not 40%, 50%. And in Cambridge, we successfully developed a site at 50% affordable housing. It was a site owned by the council. And the reason for that is that actually, it's not just about the inability for people to buy, it's the inability for people to afford to rent locally. It's the people who may, there's a portion of the population who are working, who cannot afford to rent. We've touched on teachers, people working in the health service and so forth, they aren't able to rent locally, and that's driving them away. So the other policy I proposed in the mayoral campaign was something which is called the local living rate, which at the moment, the measure of affordable rent is taking the market rent and applying a discount, typically 20%. What I propose is actually to reverse that completely, and actually shelter say that actually you should only be spending a third of your income on rent. So actually my proposal, it's not my idea, Sadiq Khan in London is proposing this, is that actually you should measure someone's rent based on a third of their income, not a discount to the market rent. And that should be a product on new affordable homes being built locally. And that will enable those people who do very important jobs in our community but may not be paid well to actually live locally, like care workers, like nurses and so forth. And that's the critical thing, because the growth is happening. We see it over in towards Love Farm. We see that growth is coming. And actually, unless we intervene in this way, that growth will not benefit this community.
Thank you. Lady just there.
Hi, my name is Holly. Thank you for actually turning up. I can't quite decide if it's an entrance or a breath of fresh air, that gentleman's not here. But my question, statistically, women are less likely to vote. Speak to me as an upcoming middle-aged woman. Make me vote for you. Would I encourage you to be concise? Let me start with you.
Okay, I think you need to look at politicians in two ways. If they belong to a party, then certainly look at the party's manifesto. If you agree with it more than you do the others, then that gives you a good point. But look at the politician themselves, because I think you can tell a lot by the person. I personally, in the past, have voted for a politician that belongs to a party that I don't agree with, because I know that they will do the best job for me in my community. So I think you need to look at, we've all sent out the election address, what we say. My details are out there. I am currently receiving about 350 emails a day from constituents within the Huntingdon constituency, asking questions. I personally do not have an office that is manned by secretaries. So I try and answer every single one of those emails myself personally. I personally try to get a response, I personally send it. And that is currently taking me half of every day. And it will continue to do so up until next Thursday, I know it. So look at the person, look at the party's politics. I'm not going to try and, well, I am going to try and sell myself, but I'm not going to do it in any way. I will make no promises to you whatsoever that I cannot keep. The only promise I have ever said that I will keep and that I've made every time I've stood for election or I can go to election is that I will do my very best to be your voice in whatever office I'm in. And that is the only promise, because I cannot promise you anything else. I'm just one person who may be in Parliament in a week's time, who may not be. But I will certainly do my very best for Huntingdonshire and for the people who live there. But I will also represent the majority. And that's what I think is very important. So I will listen to what people say. And it may well be, and I've certainly done it as a county councillor, where I have proposed, I myself was going to vote one way, but going out and talking to my constituents, the majority wanted to vote the other. And I will vote the other, because that's what I'm there for. I am not a politician who believes he knows better than the people he represents. You know what you want. You know what you need. If I'm elected to public office, it is my job to represent those needs, not to dictate to you.
Come on.
Indeed. It's about making sure that the issues that you believe in, and I must admit that actually I'm aware of who Holly is. Holly and I have known each other for a while, so I want to make that clear. I feel that it's important that you vote for a party that shares the beliefs that you hold. And I would urge everyone, if anyone's listening or watching this later on, or if you have any body you will speak to about this afterwards, please look at what the parties are actually offering, what they're standing for. And if you agree with it, vote for it. Whether you then decide to vote tactically is entirely up to you, based on that. It is also about the person that you're voting for. And I would take one point that Paul said. I would actually always vote my conscience, in the sense that I can't keep taking a straw poll. Obviously, as an MP, we would have an awful lot of people coming to us all the time with issues, and if it was a specific issue that could be dealt with by intervening on a person-to-person basis, then obviously we'd step in and use whatever influence we have. From the perspective of big broad brush strokes about kind of, oh, we feel that we should be doing this, and getting a group of lobbyists coming together, again, I would be elected by the people of Huntingdon and Lynn, to make sure that as their voice, and on women's issues especially, the Green Party is the most balanced, fair-minded, equal party. Our policies are all about making sure that everyone is treated equally and fairly in society, that no one is basically left out. It is important, one of our policies is to make sure that when it comes to representation on boards and any bodies, that we have a minimum of 40% being female, simply to make sure that you don't end up with a situation where voices aren't balanced, because it does take a joint, kind of joined up thinking, which is why the party I'm a member of has two leaders who would have both turned up last night if they'd had the option. But it's important that you have the person you vote for represents you as much as possible. But at least if you vote for that person, that you're not worried that they're going to do something different. Because if you vote Conservative, all you're going to get is platitudes here, there, left, right, and centre. Yes, for the people, we'll do it for the people. It's absolutely. And then won't be there. We'll vote for things that you didn't want, or we'll vote against things that you did want. We'll have wonderful little campaigns and then basically still nothing happens. It's important that you make the right choice, and elections are our voice, our option, our chance to have a voice, and it matters that you use them and that people across the constituency use them, and if you can, speak to everyone and get them to use them, whoever you vote for.
Thank you. Well,
firstly, It's sad that in front of you you have four white males of a certain age.
I'm joking aside, it
is really sad because actually we're not representative of the population. We're not representative of this constituency or the broader population of the country. And I know political parties have made efforts, my party has made efforts over the course of the last few years to ensure that that balance does change, but we still see it, and we see it in this general election. And so there is a deficit, I think, still, a parliamentary deficit in terms of not just women, but minorities represented in Parliament, and not just minorities, but also young people represented in Parliament. And I think that we can still do a lot more to address that issue. So that's one point. I think in terms of what I would do for you, I mean, we have policies in our manifesto that talk about equal pay and so forth, where there's still major gaps between men and women. We talk about parental leave and so forth to help couples in terms of as they start a family and sharing that responsibility. But actually, as your MP, you're voting for the individual. And it's whether or not, regardless of whether you're a man, woman, whether you're a minority or whatever, will that individual really represent you in Parliament? And will they be your voice? Because ultimately what I see the role of the MP is being the primary role, is not being a party member or being party activist or whatever. It's being a representative of the people. And actually being a voice for the people on the things that are important to you. And actually, in this election, you have a chance to take a decision to see whether or not the incumbent has been your voice in the last 2 years and the 5 years before, or whether or not you should have a fresh voice, a different voice, one that actually really represents you. And that's the choice that you have.
Nick.
And I think that the right choice for you would be me. I'm going to just use a little bit of history. I've got the benefit of a file. I think in terms of the Labour Party and standing as a Labour Party candidate, I'll stand on the record of what the Labour Party has delivered. The Labour Party has a strong record on progression, women's rights and freedoms that we can be proud of. Labour brought in the Equal Pay Act, the Sex Discrimination Act, the Equality Act, the minimum wage and introduced Sure Start. Every progressive piece of equality legislation has been delivered by Labour. And I know Tom is wearing the clothes of equality as well, and I don't doubt that is true. A failure, you could say, of the Labour Party is never to have had a female leader. I accept that, but it was in the most recent time we have Jeremy Corbyn. What I would say in terms of the Labour Party, and it was criticised heavily, but it pushed it on through, was that we have had all women shortlists. And that has made a huge difference in making sure that the representation of women and indeed other aspects of ethnic minorities, it is a broader church in terms of the Labour Party and what is on offer. You just have to look in terms of who is currently sitting on the front bench of the Labour Party, and I will give you one name. People may say that Jeremy Corbyn, and whatever happens in this general election, I hope he goes on and he continues to lead us. But there's one woman who stands out, Angela Rayner, who is the Shadow State Secretary for Education.
It's got to be Diane Abbott.
Diane Abbott is a very bright lady who has come a long way. Going back to who I actually think is a future leader of the Labour Party would be Angela Rayner. Because if you look into her background, and she is somebody who's been nurtured through the union movement, through the Labour Party, who is proud to be up front there and has been given an impressive portfolio. That is where the Labour Party has won. It has delivered in increasing representation of women. Now, on a personal level, how would I come to you? Well, first of all, I come for a haircut. You know, because that's how we first met, and that's kind of understanding. When we kind of first met, it was about knowing the little things, about, you know, listening. And this goes back to what I said at the very start. What marks me out is the different person here. Yes, we are white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant males, and from that point of view, we're terribly, terribly bland.
I'm a Roman Catholic.
Okay, my apologies. Oh, yes. Okay, white, Anglo-Saxon, white male, yeah. Of a certain age. I made an assumption.
I'm trying to make a point. All I'm trying to say is that when it comes down to it, it's about listening. And I've been doing that for many, many a year in my job. I would listen, specifically in terms of issues that are particularly pertinent to women, issues around childcare, the schools the kids are going to. It's my bread and butter every day. And if I don't win, if I don't become the Member of Parliament, which I think Huntingdon deserves, then I'll go back to the job and I'll keep listening to women and the husbands and the partners and whatever, because it's what I do. It's about listening and then representing. Compassion, cooperation, civic pride, and just being proud to represent people in an advocacy role.
Yeah, I just wanted to come back. I mean, look, I agree with Nik in general in terms of Labour historically, but I know Lillian Greenwood, who was the shadow transport spokes and resigned her cabinet position. And actually, the reality is at the moment is Labour, the parliamentary party, do not necessarily treat women the same way as they have historically. And her resignation is actually, it's a public document, she decided to write about it, how she was ignored by the leadership, how she became frustrated. Now, she's of a different political colour to me, right? But I respect her because she worked her socks off in relation to that transport brief. And actually to be ignored, and then to actually take that very difficult decision to resign, I think is an illustration of some of the frustrations that women have within the Labour parliamentary party at this point in time. So I hope that in the new parliament, that isn't the case. But that was certainly the case in the old parliament under the current leadership. And that's something that does need to be addressed. Tom.
I was listening to that about the Labour parliamentary party. But part of the reason why I can't support Labour wholeheartedly, in the sense, and that we haven't formed a progressive alliance across the, shall we say, this current mostly progressive alliance across our against the Conservatives, is basically because there is such infighting. Jeremy Corbyn is in the wrong party, in my view. He's old Labour, and the people who are sitting on that ground are currently the Greens. We are the ones with the social care kind of portfolio. We're the ones with the policies that basically will make a progressive, better future. And at the moment, you're seeing an awful lot of swapping around. The Conservatives are becoming UKIP. UKIP are trying to basically steal votes from Labour, and Labour are basically trying to steal our votes in that sense. And we're the only ones basically staying still, saying, well, no, this is what we stand for. This is who we are. And when it comes to consistency, our party has Baroness Jones, we have Molly Scott-Cato, our MEP, who's hopefully going to be the second Green MP in Bristol. I am not a female, and I am unwilling to make that transition at this stage in my life. However, I guarantee that I am a feminist, in the sense that I believe in equality. And I see no reason why anyone, I have a son and I have a daughter, anyone who tried to treat me differently, and other than the fact that she likes this and he likes that, anyone who tried to treat me differently would basically be up against me. And that is what I'd like to add.
Okay, Paul, well, a brief comment.
A couple of very brief points. Firstly, the other parties all have a party whip, and they will be expected to take that whip and to vote how they're told to vote in Parliament. We do not have a party whip, and therefore UKIP politicians can vote how they want. Secondly, it's a shame we're having a conversation as far as I'm concerned about what we can do for women. As far as I'm concerned in my party, they're completely equal, and actually as a membership we have the biggest percentage of female members of any political party in the UK. So we get that. You always got to think that UK Independence Party was the first party to stand up and fight against female genital mutilation. We were the first party to stand up and say that we've got to look at arranged marriages and forcing people to marry people they don't want. So we have been at the forefront of many policies for women, and we continue to do so. But we don't have a
way. Yeah, I need to just interject on that one small thing.
I knew
sorry. Well, just on the point of view of, yes, you have some policies, but the reason why you have those policies and the fact that you're highlighting certain aspects. Now that Brexit's over in that sense, what the purpose of UKIP is, and if anyone looks at the current tenor of the campaign, see what Paul Nuttall basically last night was basically this and this and this and this. He's saying all of this, but it's basically, it's just trying to get that idea that we stand up for this because it's about for women. We're doing it on behalf of women. It's not just Stoke and Fit. I've worked in schools and I have dealt with forced marriages and been part of that. It's about a question of education. It's about a changing of culture slowly. It's about making sure that you have an impact. But it's not about passing, shall we say, knee-jerk legislation that discriminates and causes dissension.
Okay, I want to go to a question.
Oh, yeah, no, I think if people will come with me on this one. I'm going to stretch my legs as well. Corbyn was mentioned there, and two things. You talked about a party whip. I'll tell you one thing about Jeremy Corbyn, which keeps coming up. It's a question I get asked most often about the issue of when you're speaking to the Labour candidate. Two things. Corbyn, a man of principle, a man who was stuck by his guns, and he went against the party whip many, many times and was criticised for it, but he is coming good. And I will say from a personal point of view, I don't know how many of you have actually seen him speak in public, or indeed how many of you have met him. I have. Now, I see myself as a educated person. I like to balance up the argument. I listen to every point of view on this thing, and I come to a final conclusion. When I went to the first leadership debate in Stevenage, the Hotel Ibis, that was a killer. They were all distributed in front of me. Liz Kendall, Andy Burnham, Yvette Cooper. They were all people I've met. I actually had more time for them. I've met them and I've talked to them, particularly Andy Burnham. But I went along, going back to this issue about women, I recognised the importance of a figurehead. And that was potentially, Yvette Cooper. I was going to support her because I thought, she's done a job, we'll take it there. But you know what? That man, he stood up and he held the room. Now, it was a Labour Party room, but he changed the way I looked in terms of the going forward. And I actually recommend, you know, if you can, watch as much of him as you can of Jeremy Corbyn without the interjection, without the bias of right-wing media, and you will come over to the point of view of what he has given going forward after June the 9th. He has brought back to this country an actual thought about a new direction where we're talking about democratic socialism. And there's a reason we've got more members in the Labour Party. There's a reason why we've got more people campaigning St. Neots, St. Ives, Huntingdon, throughout the whole of the area. If people have got hope and people have been enthused. So criticise a man for going against the whip, by all means. Criticise a man for his principles, by all means. But by God, he's delivering in terms of an actual desire to give something better for this country.
My name is Paul Bullen. I'm a resident of the city. I'm also a member of the Labour
Party. Freedom.
My name is George Isaacs. I'm a resident of the city. I'm also a member of the Labour Party. I came along tonight to ask what I hope for searching the questions of the panel, particularly aimed at resident member of parliament. I find that he's emulating his leader and graces by his absence.
He will be in St. Ives tomorrow, apparently. Well, so if you want to come along.
And technically, there is a vacancy for a member of parliament, so there is no sitting member at the moment.
Previously sitting member. That is semantics. So in his absence, might I, if you think the spectral, this is a rather bland meeting. It's missed the cut and thrust of the member of the ruling party being present. I ask you all to address him as I was here on any issue that you feel you would wish to address him with. So it would give us far to the end of the meeting.
Wrong.
I'm going to give you a couple of 2 minutes on this. So shall we start with the Nick?
Oh, right, straight back on. You're a devil, George. I've always made a point when I've campaigned 2 years ago and now is not to be too negative. You know, I've got enough, as I've just explained, about the positives of what I think I have to offer personally as well as my party. One thing, however, on this occasion, as I become more empowered and feel that I can talk, in some ways, Mr. Djanogly in this room probably has no greater admirer than me, because he's doing the job I want to do. He is the Member of Parliament, and within that, I look up to him. But I do not look up to his record in terms of his attendance and his work ethic. Now, I won't go on any further because I think it's unfair to attack a man when he's not here. But when it comes down to it... No. I think what I would recommend to you all, as it's kind of been alluded to over here, there are many websites where you can go to. They work for us. And I've even printed off a whole list of all the various votes as the Member of Parliament he's done over the last year. Yeah. Now, I'm going to disagree with him. We are fundamentally opposed in so many areas. But in principle, my thing I would, inverted commas, attack or bring to his attention was a woeful attendance in terms of being the local MP that I think I deserve.
Thank you.
Rob.
Well, firstly, I think my mum worked in a textile factory that his family owned in Nottinghamshire many years ago. So I come from a completely different world to your current or the previous MP. I think ultimately it's about whether or not whoever is elected takes the role of MP as something that you do with a passion 24/7. It's something that you give your all to. And I think the question that you have to ask is whether the previous incumbent has given their all to you. Have they really given their all? And have they stood up for you? And actually, regardless of who's your MP, whatever the political colour, that should be what you should be measuring them by. Now, clearly, regardless of what party you are, you aren't going to achieve everything for everybody. But you should at least, demonstrate that you have that commitment and you have that energy and you have that desire to represent the people of this constituency. And I think my perception is that, you know, other political parties who may not be present here this evening take people for granted. They just assume that this is going to happen. And the fact that they take you for granted is illustrated by the fact that they can't bother to turn up. And that is the biggest issue. That the system in some ways is broken because they know they're going to win next week. And so, why bother? And actually, hopefully, maybe there are enough of us who can actually send a different message and actually say, that is not acceptable to be your representative in Parliament and to fight for you. And actually, at the end of the day, hopefully, that message will get through to you.
Oh, your question, Jonathon Djanogly. Okay, I like to think that I'm a principled person. I've already alluded to this morning. Earlier today. But there are a couple of things I've learned through life. And one is, don't ever tell lies, because you will get found out. And the second, and probably the most important, and I don't think I'll stick to it, is never say behind somebody's back what you're not prepared to say to them face to face. So I will not say anything about Jonathon Djanogly being here or not being here, or his performance as an MP. I think you can make that decision yourself. I will go as far as to make a comment about the Conservative Party, and I've learned an awful lot about the Conservative Party since I've been in politics. And something you probably don't know is that I was a member of the Conservative Party from the age of 18 until only 6 years ago. Locally, I was a patron of the Conservative Party for 15 years. I have seen the Conservative Party change immensely in that time, and that is why I left that party and joined the UK Independence Party. Somebody once said, I can't remember who it is, but they're the nasty party. I'll say there are no two truer words ever said in British politics in my lifetime. But I won't say anything against Mr. Djanogly here, unless he's here to answer back and to debate properly. But I will tomorrow, so do come along to the listening party. And then I will tell him to the Djanogly if I get my chance what I think of him. But he will then have the chance to say what he thinks about me, but also to answer anything I say.
Tom, are you going to tell us
what
you're
going
to ask Jonathon Djanogly tomorrow?
I would like to ask him why he's a member of a party that consistently doesn't vote on behalf of the people who are actually elected. At the moment, they are trying to change the social care funding. They're going to take away people's homes, and they hoped people wouldn't notice. And then people suddenly realised that, oh, hang on, wait, you mean the house that I've actually saved up for, I'm going to lose just because I'm out of the lottery, I might need help when I'm older. I would ask him why he doesn't, I mean, he doesn't vote against, as far as I can tell, looking at They Work For You, I get the odd email ping as well when he speaks in Parliament. He makes nice little short speeches. But I would ask him why he doesn't vote against his party. Again, it's a question of the party whip. But when it comes to the bedroom tax, when it comes to the dementia tax, which is coming, when it comes to basically cutting funding, when it comes to all of these things, he doesn't stand up for Huntingdon. He doesn't stand up for these things, and I would ask him why. I would ask him, I used to be a member of the Conservative Party. Again, when I was young, I know. I feel the privilege. I feel a need, confessional. To be fair, I got an even worse moment in my life. I was a Lib Dem. No, weirdly enough, because it's only Blair. I never trusted him at all. Yeah. No, I started off conservative. When I grew up, John Major seemed like an honourable bloke. I never really liked Margaret Thatcher, but when I was four, you see pictures of her basically in a tank, you go, ooh. So I, big impression. It's kind of, that was very, And then in the 90s, basically, Ken Clark was one of my little heroes. My friend knew him and stuff like that. So just a question for me, it's kind of, there's been a progression, but the Conservatives have changed. And the thing I'd like to ask the people of Huntingdon is, are they still the same party that you keep voting for? Are they representing you? Are they what they used to be? And they're not. They're big business. They're basically out to fleece you. And sell off your stuff behind your back without you noticing. And I would ask Mr. Djanogly, why haven't you stopped me doing that?
Thank you very much. I'm a very Catholic Anglican. I do hear professions about politics. So, lady and Bird, and our
board.
I feel like burdened.
Okay, Joe Fisher from Branson, also a member of the Labour Party, and also a supporter of the Women's Equality Party. So that's something for us women to think about, because they're a good party as well. What I would like to ask, we've got a new president in the USA who's going to do something about climate change. I'd like to ask all four here, what is their stand on climate change? What is it their party would really do about it? I know this will appeal to the Greens, but it should appeal to every one of us sitting here and standing here, because it is a great concern. And I think that I don't see any mention of it anywhere. Maybe not have read it, but I don't see any mention of it in any sort of public debate. And yet I think for the future of my grandchildren, we should be having this debate and taking it seriously.
Thank you. I would like to speak to you.
It is absent from the debate. It's remarkable how much the biggest problem facing this country is ignored, and in the idea that Brexit is a huge thing. Brexit is relatively easy to solve if you do it rationally. At the moment, we just have warring parties doing it completely irrationally. But from the point of view of the biggest, largest, most important thing that we have to face, global warming, climate change, the impact that is going to have on the world, it's just immeasurable. Last night, during the election debate, Caroline Lucas finally, hurrah, she managed to actually get a word in on climate change. And yet you'll still get people denying it happened. You get people, I was only speaking to a gentleman today who basically said, I'm not sure I believe in that. But 99% of scientists do, and I'm a science teacher, yes they do. And I'm a science teacher, and I have to go with the evidence. I have seen how it works. You can put a vial of carbon dioxide, you can have a candle at one end, a thermal imaging camera at the other end, turn on the carbon dioxide and the heat disappears. You can't see it with a thermal camera, simply because the carbon dioxide is absorbing the heat, trapping it there. The more carbon dioxide we release into the atmosphere, the more the world warms. That will expand the oceans, let alone causing ice to melt, flooding the place. It'll basically just make the water expand. You end up with the methane deposits at the bottom of the ocean beginning to melt. You end up with the permafrost in Russia melting and huge amounts of methane being released. And methane's 20 times worse than carbon dioxide as a greenhouse gas. And when that happens, from the bottom of frozen lakes and basically broken detritus from the bottom of the muds, it's going to cause major, major problems. I have young children. Honestly, part of me, when I moved, I was looking at the sat-nav just to make sure it was high enough that I could live there for the next 50 years, because I am concerned. At the moment, there is a huge iceberg about to carve off of the Antarctic. It made a jump of about 13 kilometres only yesterday. Global climate change is the largest, biggest problem that we face. And there are solutions. There are so many ideas and things we could do. We could basically massively reduce the amount of fossil fuels we're using. We could use them now as a stepping stone towards renewable power. Instead, we have and this is one thing I will criticise him for, an MP who basically says, no, we don't want any more wind turbines. And you can see them from the end of his house. They're just basically, they're not bad. I like them. I walk up on the hill above Auchinbury. I think they're beautiful. We can basically hydroelectric with Swansea Bay tidal and then replicating that around the country. But we've got to stop burning fossil fuels. We've got to leave them in the ground, because we cannot, at the moment, adapt fast enough. Global warming has happened cyclically over the years, up and down. But the problem with the current situation is that we all live near the water. St. Neots is based on a river. London is a tidal river up until basically Whitney. You have New York, Washington, Bangladesh. And if you think we have problems with refugees right now, wait till Bangladesh, with a population of over 150 million, basically starts trying to find a new place to live as the Ganges suddenly floods and all the river delta's gone. And you've got Myanmar next to it, you've got India and nuclear power, who frankly haven't been having a great relationship with the Muslim population, and you've got China to the north and mountains. You're going to have catastrophe unless we learn how to deal with it. So we have to invest. We have to be outward-looking. We can't be inward-looking. We can't deny it's happening just in the idea that basically we need to... No, it's about business. It's a problem. It's a green tax on jobs. It's a farce. And we have to do something about it.
Okay, I'm
clapping the guy next to me, because basically, Joe, when it comes down to it, I'm not a climate denier. I think climate change is happening. I'm very much of an understanding of the need to follow science and invest in green energy, wind farms. I think what the Labour Party, and indeed if I was to be elected, I'd do the first thing to listen to an expert and a science teacher, and I would be looking to the people who probably currently vote green. I think the practicalities of that rapid change to a green economy, which is what I would have to say I would want to work towards, obviously. We're talking about, you know, getting rid of diesel cars, but there are people who are running diesel cars who were encouraged to use them because a big business suggested it was good for the environment. We've got to be practical about it. And in terms of the transition to a very admirable and a very honourable state, I would applaud, and I would be one of the people who, within the Labour Party, would, I think, be one of the more greener MPs. I really have nothing more to add. I know when I talk about the NHS, I'm on a favourable wicket. On this one, I will just bow to the expert.
So I see climate change at three levels. The first one is our role as a country in terms of being a voice regarding climate change on the global stage. And unfortunately, what I've seen in the last couple of years is that we are stepping back from that role. And I think that moving on to the second point, which is Brexit and the impact of climate change as a result of Brexit, that will exaggerate that retrenchment, that stepping back from the global stage. Now, if you look at, there's a very good, Friends of the Earth have done an excellent document which looks at what the impact of Brexit could be for us as a result of stepping out of the environmental legislation, that basically over the last 20 years, Europe has improved. The reason we have clean beaches now is not because of our own domestic legislation, it's European legislation. And the fear that Friends of the Earth and other green organisations have is that this government will basically retreat and rewind all that good work that's been invested over not just 20 years, but 30 or 40 years. As part of our membership of the EU. So at that level, I think I am really worried. I am really worried, because actually that was a lot of hard work that people now benefit from. But then at the final level, which is how it impacts you locally. And actually, as I've listened to people across this constituency, they're really concerned about congestion. Congestion in St. Neots, congestion in Huntingdon, and all the fumes and air pollution. And if you actually look at the measures of air pollution, St. Neots and Huntingdon have some of the highest levels within the region. Brampton as well. So we need to have a strategy. We need to have a strategy for reducing those levels of air pollution. We cannot just basically say, people who own diesel cars, you can't drive them anymore. We have to have a carrot as well as the stick. And that carrot is making sure there is good public transport infrastructure. And if you look at, for example, at the growth in Elkenbury Wear, have a look at the transport document for that development. All it says is more cars. I can tell you, that's all it says. It has a couple of paragraphs on this aspiration for a train station. Merely an aspiration. No commitment at all. And that illustrates the wrong direction we're going in. Now look, I own an electric car. It has consequences for you in terms of where you travel and getting recharged and so forth. But that's something I'm prepared to do, because actually, it's not just about our future. It's about the future of our children and future generations. And we have to act. We have to act now. And actually, I welcome the fact that actually, if we can roll out more sustainables, I think a month ago, for the first time in 100 years, this country was powered by sustainable power without fossil fuel. Now, that's fantastic. It only lasted about 24 hours. But that is an illustration of what we can achieve. And what we need to do is not roll back, but invest more, and more rapidly. I agree completely. But instead of being the green, it should have the green quality house look kite mark, which is basically, there was 5 codes, code 1 to code 5. Code 5 is the most sustainable build in terms of housing. That was scrapped, but actually green continued with that level of sustainability. And it has a kite mark in relation to the quality of housing. And I agree completely that actually if you look at some of the houses that are being built at the moment, they're not at code 5, they're at a code 2 or code 3. And the district councils are letting developers get away with it. And that has to stop. Because actually, that energy, the efficiency of the home is an important component in terms of energy efficiency and energy saving. And that's something certainly that as an MP, I would be championing.
Paul, would you like to come
on? Okay, I think this is a bigger subject that we need. There's a lot. And the first thing you said is you haven't seen anything written about it. Well, I have a copy of our manifesto in front of me, and you're more than welcome to have a look at it. But it looks at climate in 3 areas. It looks at it as part of the environment, part of it about our transportation system, and part of it about the future of energy. Now, I would agree, nobody has said that there isn't climate change. What the argument is about is whether that climate change is man-made or not. And I know Tom has his views of Greens, but I've looked at the fact I'm an engineer, and there is no conclusive proof that it is. However, we are... Now, sorry, you will say there is, you'll find another scientist who'll say there isn't. So it's...
That's not you 99ers.
And actually, I allowed you to speak. So if you allow me to speak, that would be very good one of the questions. So there are always two sides to a debate. So, you know, I don't agree that it's man-made, but I do agree with the custodians. And if you're looking on manifesto, you'll see a lot of policies in there, and we do support renewable energy where it's efficient, effective, and costly, and at the right cost efficient. Look at wind turbines. Tom's already set the roof. Right, I am an engineer, I know this for a fact, I've looked at it, I've been to the kitchen. The average wind turbine is designed to last for 25 years. It takes 35 years to produce the same amount of energy that was consumed in its manufacture. So you tell me that's efficient. It isn't. Electricity in this country at the moment is still the most polluting energy source we have. That's a fact. So we need to look at that. And you're talking about clean air. the dirtiest city in the UK the year before last was Cambridge. It didn't hit the news, apart from the fact the results were in. It didn't hit the news why, and the reason it's dirty is because all the bus fleets in Cambridge at the time used biofuel. Biofuel was supposed to be a sustainable energy that the Green Party actually said we should grow. So, you know, lots of things are coming back now that have proved that these experts, and let's face it, an X is a half, has been, and a spurt is a small jet of water at external pressure. You know, all wrong. They're frequently wrong. Look at the data they present, and look at how much data they threw away that says the exact opposite. Because the way you get the data you want is to get rid of all the corresponding data that says something different, and just use that. So yes, we need to look at it, we need to be custodians of the planet, but I will not believe that the current climate change is man-made. It isn't. And the Green Deal, as was, not great change, was the best idea any government ever had to take money from the poor and give it to the rich. So let's not even go back to that if you want.
Paul's facts are sometimes facts and sometimes they're not. And actually, in my day job, I do a lot of work in the wind energy sector, and I can tell you the return, the cost of paying back the building of a wind turbine is currently 10 years. And the life expectancy, they have wind turbines in Denmark and Sweden, which are still going up 40 years, and actually they're refurbishing them. So, actually, I don't know where Paul gets his facts from, but my facts are based on my day job and spending a lot of time in this sector. And I can just say, in relation to tidal, you know, you have a great opportunity in relation to tidal around the country, and the payback there is even better, because the reliability of the predictability of the energy generation gives you a much more attractive payback. And actually, the pilot farm they're using in Scotland has demonstrated that quite recently.
Can I just come back on one thing there? And Ron is correct. But what he's telling you, this is where I'm saying, look at the data and look at two states. The data I gave him was without green subsidies. The data he gave him was with the green subsidies.
Oh. Versus all the subsidies for the fossil fuel industry.
It wasn't.
There is another problem with fossil fuels, is the fact that we're going to run out. They don't last forever. They formed over hundreds of millions of years. Depending on whether you believe that in that timescale. However, we've gone through most of them in the last 100 years. So unless we transition, what are we going to actually be using once we've run out of coal? Even though we have a large amount of coal, but we saw what happened in the 1950s when you have huge amounts of smog and you needed a Clean Air Act, which even Churchill basically was trying to deal with. The issues we have is that we need to transition. We are at a phase now where basically we still have fossil fuels. They aren't going to go away overnight, but unless we actually have the impetus to actually start moving forwards and really put almost industrialised, World War II level of industrial car output towards this, then what are the options? We're going to basically be having cars that can't move. So at the end of the day, we have a chance to become an industry leader across the world in new modern technologies. And for me, if we don't do it, it's a lost opportunity and possibly the end of a civilization. Because when you can't heat your house because the gas isn't there, when you can't move your car because the oil wasn't there, suddenly we're going to be back to horse and cart. And that's not going to work out well for, shall we say, modern economy. And for me, again, the word expert comes from experience, the same Latin root. And if we don't listen to the people who've got the experience of looking at climate change, we're all doomed and basically no better than Michael Gove.
Thank you. Fossil fuels will run out. Time has run out, I'm afraid. I'm sorry if there are people who want to ask questions and we haven't gone around to. There's another opportunity, I gather, in St Ives tomorrow. So please go and take advantage of that. I think on behalf of everyone here, I'd like to thank our four panelists for being here tonight, to wish them all the luck they need and deserve in next Thursday's election, and to thank all of you.